You know, as you talk about that, I remember going to a state-run orphanage in Uganda, and then going to a Rafiki orphanage, and they had some children there who had come over from the state. Well, in the state-run orphanage, they would put the food sometimes in the middle of the table, and it was literally a matter of only the strong survive. So therefore, when some of those children who came from the state orphanage went to the Rafiki orphanage, when they would eat, they would cover the bowl. They would try to protect the bowl and surround it with their arms so that no one else would take it. And then they were given toys and new clothes at night. And when they would lay down, they would try to put the clothes that they had been given under their pillow so no one would take it. And one of the things that had to be instructed on is these are yours. You're no longer in the state orphanage. Mm. These are yours. You don't have to protect your food. No one is going to take your food.
Yeah.
No one is going to take your clothes when you lay down at night. You can rest assured this is yours. It's going to be here tomorrow.
Wow.
And it took weeks and sometimes months for that thinking to be eradicated from their mind.
That's a great point. And that's what Paul's describing.
Several years back, we saw some of this in the Shawshank Redemption.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The guys who were let out.
Yep.
Yeah.
Brooks.
Couldn't handle it.
Couldn't handle it.
And the thing that we see here with Paul is that we can't either.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, we can't handle it. And if you think the day after you, quote unquote, invited Jesus into your heart, you are going to be walking on clouds, talk to a Christian who's been a Christian for about 20, 30 years.
Well, you know, what's so insidious about misreading this passage is the poor Christian who struggles with sin is told that, well, you're a carnal Christian, you're living in defeat instead of the victory of Romans chapter 8. You need to get out of this condition, you need to move on.
Yeah.
When in reality, the person who is undergoing sanctification and making the most progress, that person is probably the one who's saying, I am a sinful wretch. They're realizing how sinful they are, and the realization of how sinful we are at our core isn't a sign that we're carnal and not living up to the standard. It's the sign that the blessed Holy Spirit is sanctifying us, that we're having the struggle.
So we get more and more sick of ourselves the more we grow in holiness.
Exactly. At least we should, in theory, we should.
You know, you bring up an important point there, Kim, reference to, I think, the way a lot of us were raised to think of Romans 6 as, you know, one stage of the Christian life. So, you know, you are spiritual, you're regenerate, you're no longer dead in sin, you're alive, you have a new spirit. And then you get to Romans 7, and that describes a carnal Christian. Here's someone who falls back into carnality and no longer is walking in the Spirit, no longer has the Spirit. He is a carnal Christian. He may still be saved, but as by fire. Then you have Romans 8, the victorious Christian again, who is conquering and growing and so forth. The real way to look at this is, and it's so revolutionary, is that the Christian Paul is describing in Romans 6, 7, and 8 is not only the same person, but the same person at the very same moment.
Amen. Yes.
Every single Christian is simultaneously defined by Romans 6, Romans 7, and Romans 8. So you can't be a defeatist. Look at Romans 6. You can't be a triumphalist. Look at Romans 7. You can only be a Christian realist.
Romans 8.
Romans 8.
Yeah. Romans 8.
We're groaning. We're longing. We're waiting.